As far as the functioning of the Ganashangas, we have the Phrygian Confederacy in the 6th century BC, where we have that they were different kinds of clans. But all these clans ruled independently, and sometimes they had their own independent point of view. But when a decision had to be taken, it was through an assembly. The term Gano, it actually means a group of people, and when the term Shangho is added to it, it means an assembly. We have also another term called Ganarajya, which meant governance. So these Ganarajyas were used to a kind of polity where you have governance by a cluster of people and not a rule by a single monarch. Now this type of polity has been explained in different ways by the historians of early India. We can cite the example of a nationalist historian, K.P. Jaiswal, who has actually talked of this Ganashanga type of polity as a form of democracy in early India. This view has of course been questioned, because if we think of democracy, we find that in the Ganashanga, it was the certain group of people who actually ruled. So it was not a very democratic way of functioning, and the opinions of the common people was not taken into account. So in no way we can say that Ganashanga was akin to democracy. J.P. Sharma, who has worked on the Ganashangas, has taken a more positive approach, and generally we find that scholars designate the Ganashangas as republic or a kind of oligarchical form of government, where you have a group of people ruling, and within that group a few is the actual ruler. So thus we find that we have different types of opinion regarding the functioning of the state. Romila Thapar feels that if we look at the Ganashangas, it is more like a proto-state, and we had the form of chiefdoms in early India in the Vedic period, and from chiefdoms we can move into a state where you have the formation of a state without any actual functioning. So she prefers to call it a proto-state. Now regarding the governance or the functioning of the Ganashangas, we find that they are generally organized in an assembly, and it's a more like a corporate sector where you have a group of people who belong to the ruling clans. We find two sets of names, the Rajakula and the Dasakarmakara. The Rajakulas actually referred to the royal kinsmen, and the Dasakarmakaro were the non-kin laborers. So we do not have any middle strata in this whole structure of the Ganashangas type of polity. So while explaining their functioning, we have seen that Buddhist texts talk of an assembly, and we have examples of discussions in that assembly. Whenever there was any dissension, then they used to go for voting. And through voting, they used to come to a positive point. So thus, it was more a decision of a group of people rather than a decision of a single monarch. There would have been ministers to advise the chief of the clan, but the decision of the assembly was final. And therefore, this kind of Ganashangas were little dreaded by the monarchical polity, because their main strength was their cohesion, the main strength was their unity. And it is actually this cohesion and this unity which took them along ahead, and which could they had the resilience to fight the big monarchical powers through their cohesion. If we look at the Buddhist texts, we find that Buddha professed it. If the Ganashangas can stay together, and if they are cohesive in their attitude, then no power on earth can actually defeat them.